Okay, well, thanks for inviting me. This is my first QCrypt. It's a great conference. And so I'll talk about the thing that I've done, which is most closely related to quantum crypto, you know, although I'm not really a crypto person, which is quantum money. And I had some older work with Paul Christiano on public key quantum money. But today I'm going to talk about something newer, which is some work on private key quantum money. So look, ever since there's been money, you know, there have been people trying to counterfeit it. You know, this problem has a long history in physics. I mean, even Isaac Newton, in sort of his other career, besides physicist and alchemist, as, you know, master of the mint, worried a lot about, you know, how to make the English coins harder to counterfeit. Newton also personally oversaw hangings of counterfeiters. That's not a solution that's going to be available to us today. That's kind of like the forced entry solution. So we're gonna. But okay, what's done today? You know, I mean, modern currency has all sorts of special features on it that are supposed to make it harder to counterfeit. Holograms, micro printing, special inks. In some countries, they even print bills made out of plastic. You know, but this all, you know, leads to an arms race with no obvious winner. I mean, from a computer science perspective, at least, having uncopyable cash just seems fundamentally impossible for rather trivial reasons, right? Any printing device that the good guys can build, you know, a sufficiently determined bad guy can build also, right? It's just a, you know, a question of time and money. You know, taking, if we think of a bill as corresponding to a string of information, well, copying a string is an easy computation. Okay, so what's done in practice, of course, is to use a third party, a trusted third party to get around this problem. Okay, this is what a credit card agency is, for example, or PayPal. So, you know, you contact them every time you want to buy or sell something. Many of you may have heard about Bitcoin, which has been in the news, and which is sort of a very, very interesting exception to this that proves the rule. This is a system for online currency where you still need a trusted third party in some sense, but but this third party is now distributed among servers that are all over the internet. Okay, but you know, in fact, Bitcoin has had some security problems, you know, related to the vulnerability of these servers. You know, and so sometimes you really want cash. I mean, so what kind of users would need that? Well, you know, pimps, drug dealers, money launderers, hitmen. You know, so we want, you know, a solution that will, you know, work for this user base. Okay, so and this seems fundamentally impossible. You know, at least in classical physics. So what can we do? All right, well, you know where this is going. We have the no cloning theorem. Okay, so you know, even before the no cloning theorem was named sort of as a theorem, Stephen Wiesner already in the late 60s, you know, had a remarkably prescient paper where he proposed the idea of quantum money. So you know, and then I think was unable to get the paper published for 15 years. Okay, but this was in some sense the first quantum information idea. And you know, and Wiesner's scheme was extremely simple. So besides, so each bill would have on it a classical serial number, call it S, but then also a collection of qubits, which would be in, you know, one of what we now know as the four BB84 states, 0, 1, plus or minus. And, you know, these qubits would just sort of stay on the bill. And now, in a giant database, the bank would remember how it prepared every quantum state on every bill in circulation. Okay, so the bank stores, say, a function mapping each serial number S to F of S, which is a description of these BB84 states on the bill, a classical description of it. Okay, so now, you know, you can trade these bills, but now, you know, if you want to verify one, what you do is you take it back to the bank. Okay, and then the bank, you know, looks up in its database, you know, what's the entry for the serial number S, and that tells it in what basis should it measure each of the qubits. Okay, in the 0, 1, or in the plus minus basis. Okay, and then, of course, it checks that each measurement gives the expected outcome. Okay, but you know, at least at a hand waving level, if someone doesn't have this data, the secret database that the bank has, then it should be, you know, physically impossible to copy the money. Okay, because you know there are n, let's say, qubits, right? There's an overwhelming chance that you're going to measure at least one of them in the wrong basis. Okay, if you measure it in the wrong basis, not only do you fail to make a copy, but you also destroy the copy that you had before. Okay. So, okay, well, you know, there are some practical problems with quantum money. So, you know, this would really be money that burns a hole in your pocket, okay, so to speak, right? So, you know, I learned from Fernando's talk earlier this week that the world record for keeping a qubit coherent at room temperature is now about 2 seconds. Okay, so, you know, maybe for high frequency trading, this would be okay, right? But, you know, this is sort of the, you know, the limit on how long your money is going to last. Okay, so to make this practical, you know, we would need qubits that, you know, that stay coherent for months or years or whatever, but, and that you can keep in your wallet and, you know, move around. And so, you know, so these are, there are some engineering difficulties here. Okay. But you know, you might, you know, also think that there's a more fundamental problem, right? Isn't the very act of verifying the bill, you know, going to destroy the bill just in principle? Okay, well, the answer to that is interestingly no. And the reason is you know, a basic fact about quantum information that goes under different names. Some people call it the gentle measurement lemma. I've called it the almost as good as new lemma. Okay, and basically what it says is that if you've got a quantum state and you make say a two-outcome measurement on it, and if given knowledge of the state, you could predict the outcome of this measurement almost with certainty, say with probability 1 minus epsilon, then after the measurement, you can recover a state that has trace distance at most square root of epsilon from the state you started with. Okay, so, you know, the in other words, like no information, you know, little information, little disturbance. Okay, so because you know of you know valid money, you know in advance that yes, it should pass the verification, so you gain little information and the state is not disturbed by much. Okay, of course, a counterfeit money could indeed be destroyed by the verification, but we don't care about that. Okay, but now a second problem you might notice with Wiesner's scheme is, you know, isn't it cumbersome for the bank to have to maintain this gigantic database, you know, and keep track of a description of every bill in circulation, right? And then you'd have to replicate this database like at every, you know, so, you know, isn't there like a better way to do this where the bank would only have to remember, say, a single polynomial-sized secret? Okay, well, this was, you know, again, you know, very, very early on, a solution to this problem was pointed out by Bennett, Broussard, Breitbart, and Wiesner, and what they said is that in place of this random function f, which maps the serial numbers to the description of the quantum states, simply substitute a pseudo-random function. Okay, so the bank would just need to remember a single key k. Okay, that key better not leak out, or the entire currency system will collapse. Okay, but then using that key K and using the serial number S, they can then compute how to prepare, you know, a bill with serial number S, right? And it'll just prepare the state encoded by the string F sub K of S. Okay. So this is the scheme. Now, you know, you'll notice that, you know, here we're not only assuming quantum mechanics, we're also assuming that this pseudo-random function really is cryptographically secure. Right, so there's an additional assumption. Okay, but you might, you know, wonder, is that all that we need to assume? All right, well, again, you know, at least at a hand wavy level, you know, it seems like yes. Okay, and here's sort of the intuition. Well, suppose that we could copy the bills in this BBBW scheme. Okay, then intuitively, if we can sort of create new bills with the same serial numbers that we already saw, then we would also be breaking, you know, Wiesner's original scheme, right? If we could do it sort of, or let me say it better. If we could do it not, you know, distinguishing f sub k from a random function, well, then we would also be breaking, you know, Wiesner's original scheme. But if we could do it, you know, in a way that did depend on f sub k not being a random function, well, then by that very fact, we would be distinguishing f sub k from a random function. So f sub k would not be pseudo-random. Okay, so you know, we'll talk later about how to formalize this intuition. Actually, from from the standpoint of BBBW, we can give an interesting reinterpretation of Wiesner's original scheme, which is that we can say that Wiesner's original scheme was really just the BBBW scheme, but in the case where this function f sub k happens to be computed using a random oracle. Okay, so it's implementing BBBW within the random oracle model, if you like. And so that perspective will let us sort of treat the Wiesner and the BBBW schemes in a completely unified way. Okay, we can continue sort of pointing out problems here, and we could say, look, you know, if in order to verify a bill you have to take it back to the bank, well, you know, doesn't that sort of defeat the purpose of having cash? In the first place, the whole purpose of cash was to sort of cut out the middleman, right? So yes, you know, this is an issue, and this is precisely the reason why a lot of recent research has been about public key quantum money. This is a term that I gave to it about 4 years ago, and you know, it simply means quantum money where the verification procedure is public. Okay, so anyone knows how to verify a bill, but it should still be hard to copy a bill if you're not the bank. Okay, now I claim that, you know, if public key quantum money is possible at all, you know, it's not obvious that it is, then it will certainly require a computational assumption in addition to just the no cloning theorem. Okay, why? Well, you know, imagine that the counterfeiter has unlimited computation time. Okay, the counterfeiter knows a description of the verification procedure, right? That's public. So the counterfeiter could simply do a brute force search through all possible quantum states, you know, looking for one that passes the verification. Okay, so we're going, you know, so if this money is possible, then it's going to have to, you know, use the fact that okay, the counterfeiter is polynomial time bounded. Okay, but that's fine. You know, we love making that sort of assumption in cryptography. So suppose we make it, then what can we do? You know, and this has turned out to be, you know, an extremely rich and interesting question. You know, we do have some proposals now for public key quantum money schemes. You know, that are, you know, and they're based on some interesting ideas. So there were several that were already broken. So I'm not putting those on this slide. Okay, but you know, the ones that are standing, I think there's one by Farhi, Peter Shor, and some of their students and postdocs that's based on knot theory, actually, based on the Alexander polynomial, which is a certain knot invariant. So you know, it's a very complicated scheme based on very, you know, interesting mathematical ideas, and it is secure under the assumption that it can't be broken. You know, that's about all we can say about the security of this scheme. More recently, Paul Cristiano and I came up with a very different scheme for public key quantum money, which is based on hidden subspaces of like GF2 to the n, which are encoded using multivariate polynomials. And this scheme, you know, we can actually give some sort of arguments for its security. So we can prove that it's secure in a black box setting, unconditionally, and in a non-black box setting, you know, in the real world, we can show that it's secure under some cryptographic assumption, you know, about multivariate polynomial cryptography, which is a bit of a non-standard assumption, but it has nothing to do with quantum money. Okay, the assumption just says that some classical cryptographic task, you know, is hard for a quantum computer, which, you know, it, as far as we know, it is. Okay, and if that's true, then our whole money scheme is secure. Okay, so now the goal of this talk is going to be to try to leverage, you know, all this recent understanding that we've gotten of public key quantum money in order to go back and solve some of the remaining open problems about private key quantum money. Okay, so you might say, you know, open problems about private key quantum money, wasn't, you know, all of this done in the 60s, you know, 70s, 80s, like, you know, huge time ago? All right, so I'm going to mention three questions. Okay, a first sort of, you know, obvious question is, are the Wiesner and BBBW schemes actually secure? You know, and I was, surprised when I first got into this that no rigorous security proof, you know, had ever been written down. Okay, but today, you know, because of, you know, so, you know, a bunch of work that's been done recently and then, you know, a little ingredient that I'll supply, yes, we can give a fully complete, rigorous, and unified security proof for these schemes. Okay, but now a second question is, you know, I showed you this, you know, Wiesner scheme that was unconditionally secure but required a giant database, and I showed you this BBBW variant which got rid of the giant database but required a computational assumption. Okay, so it would be natural to wonder, is there an inherent trade-off here? Okay, could you have a private key quantum money scheme which was unconditionally secure but, you know, that had no giant database? Okay, so that's something one could ask, right? You know, it seems like maybe not, but how could you prove it? Okay, so, and then thirdly, it was noticed, you know, by me and independently by, you know, many other people that Wiesner's scheme, you know, and the BBBW scheme are insecure if the counterfeiter is allowed to interact adaptively with the bank. Okay, submit, you know, repeated queries. And this is very easy to see. So suppose that this here is a bill that we would like to counterfeit. Suppose that this is a legitimate bill, okay, and we would like to learn all of the quantum states that are on it. Okay, so what can we do? Well, we just repeatedly submit this bill to the bank, but vary the first qubit randomly. Okay, and we figure out for which setting of the first qubit, you know, does the bank accept this? Okay, and this is not going to damage any of the other qubits because those are all being measured in the correct basis. All right, and then once we know classically what's the right state of the first qubit, then we just fix it to that state, and now we just try all the possible settings for the second qubit, and so on. Okay, so in nearly linear time, we've learned the state of the bill. Okay, so an obvious question is, can we have a private key quantum money scheme which is secure against these interactive attacks? Okay, so our results, you know, the paper is still in preparation. In fact, one reason why I'm giving this talk was to try to force myself to write the paper. So as I said, you know, we get this rigorous unified security proof, building on, a lot of prior work that studied this, like by Molina, Vidic, and Watrous, Werner, Dmitry Gavinsky, Pastowski et al. I'll show how if the counterfeiter has unlimited computation time, then they can break any BBBW-like scheme. Okay, so in other words, yes, there is such a trade-off. Okay, if you want the bank to only have a small key, then your scheme has to depend on a computational assumption. Okay. And, you know, this is probably the most technically novel part of the talk to prove this. You know, I use, you know, it's really kind of amazing. I, you know, am able to sort of break these schemes using only a paperclip and some magnets. All right, not really, but, and some toilet paper, yes, no. Okay, but no, just using some really simple quantum information tools, but, you know, but sort of a little not obvious how to combine them. Okay, so, and then thirdly, I'll point out that, I'll explain how the earlier work that Paul Cristiano and I did on public key quantum money and on, you know, this hidden subspace scheme, which was provably secure in a black box setting, how that actually immediately gives you also a private key quantum money scheme, which is provably secure against, even against interactive attacks. Okay, so but to talk about this first, you know, we need to formally define what is private key quantum money. All right, so here's a definition of a private key quantum money scheme. So, you know, we'll take it to consist of two polynomial time algorithms, the bank, which generates the banknote, you know, and the verifier, which accepts or rejects a claimed banknote. Okay, and both of these get access to the secret key. And so, you know, there are two things we care about. First, that any valid bill should be accepted with probability close to one. That's, you know, it should in other words, there should be small completeness error. You know, and in fact, in many schemes, the completeness error will simply be zero. Okay, and secondly, that it should be hard to counterfeit a bill. Okay, that you have to think a bit about, you know, how to formalize it, but I think a reasonable formalization is that, you know, if you're given any polynomial number of legitimate bills, then, you know, no polynomial time counterfeiting algorithm C should be able to prepare a state, you know, on some larger number of registers, such that if you run the verifier on each of those registers, then, you know, it has a non-negligible probability of telling you that you have more money than you started with. Okay, so you know, so here we're allowing, you know, an attack that might require many legitimate bills. You know, it might be probabilistic. The output state might be entangled between all the different, you know, alleged money registers. Okay, all of that is allowed here, and still, you know, you shouldn't be able to increase your money with any non-negligible probability. Okay, so this delta should be like less than 1/ polynomial, you know, ideally 1/ exponential in N, which is, say, the size of the key or is our security parameter. Okay, now another important concept will be that of a mini scheme, which is a private key quantum money scheme, which only needs to be secure if you have one bill in your entire, you know, current in your entire money system. Okay, and it should just be hard to copy it and make two bills. Okay, so just like sort of we did previously with public key quantum money, where we started with mini schemes and then sort of built full-blown money schemes out of them. We'll do the same in the private key case, and we'll prove that, you know, any mini scheme really does give rise to a full-blown money scheme. Okay, so to give an example, the Wiesner mini scheme would just be you take the serial number and you directly encode it into BB84 states, and there's no serial number on the bill. You know, you don't need one. There's only one bill. Okay, so it was proved recently by Molina, Vidic, and Watrous that the Wiesner mini scheme has soundness error, which is exactly 3/4 to the n, if there are n qubits. Interestingly, this is tight, but sort of the counterfeiting strategy is quite non-obvious. If you do sort of the obvious counterfeiting strategy, you can check that this will succeed with probability only 5/8 to the n. Okay, but there's a less obvious way that actually produces, you know, it goes qubit by qubit, but for each qubit, it produces a 2-qubit entangled state, which then gets split across the two bills. Okay, the proof of this uses the quantum games formalism of Gutowski and Watrous, and, you know, which basically, you know, is like a hammer that just reduces this whole thing to a semi-definite program that you then just have to solve. I should mention, you know, this actually came, you know, the origin was that I posted on, oh, I'm sorry, not on Math Overflow, on Physics Stack Exchange, that, you know, has anyone actually proved the security of Wiesner's scheme rigorously? And so I'm happy that then someone did it. There have been subsequent results, which Fernando mentioned in his talk. Like, you can even make all the communication between the verifier and the bank classical. Although, if you do that, then in Gavinsky's scheme, then the bill can only be used a linear number of times before it completely degrades, and then, you know, the bank has to give you a fresh bill. Okay, so that's one, you know, asterisk with his scheme. And then, as Fernando talked about, you know, you can even tolerate some amount of noise. And still get a secure scheme. Okay, so let me give you what I'll call the standard construction of a money scheme from a mini scheme. Okay, and this will just, you know, repeat what you saw with the BBBW scheme. Okay, so suppose we have a mini scheme where each key K gets mapped to, you know, a money state dollars sub K. Okay, then how do we construct a money scheme out of that? Well, we'll also need a pseudo random function. Okay, actually a random or a pseudo random function. You know, I'll call it F sub K. Okay, and then our full money states will then consist of a serial number together with dollar sub F sub K of S. Okay, so now we introduce serial numbers, and then we apply our pseudorandom function to the serial number, you know, in order to decide, you know, which of the states in the mini scheme to prepare. Okay, and now the theorem that one wants to prove here is, well, suppose that this money scheme is not secure. Okay, then that could only be for one of two reasons, right? Either of the underlying mini scheme was also insecure, or else this F sub K was not really a pseudo-random function. You know, it could be distinguished from random. Okay, now intuitively this is pretty kind of obvious, but you know, if there's one thing that sort of I've tried to contribute to this field of quantum money, it's sort of to prove, you know, the theorems that sort of other people didn't even recognize needed to be proved. So, you know, you're welcome. So I, you know, saw it as my task to, you know, to prove this. But notice that once we get it, then Wiesner and BBBW are both handled automatically, right? If F sub K is pseudo-random, then it's BBBW. If it's truly random, then it's Wiesner. Okay. So the proof sketch is that you actually look at this new money scheme, M prime, and you first show that at least it's secure when considered as a mini scheme. Okay, and so, you know, you show that, you know, if it's not, then either you could break, you know, the original mini scheme, or you could distinguish F sub K from random. And then once you have that, then you bootstrap to showing that M prime is secure as a money scheme. Okay, and, you know, I think the intuition is very natural that you know, if you can copy bills, but, you know, with the same serial numbers that you saw before, then, you know, you should be able to break the mini scheme, right? Because you're copying the, you know, the bills. If you can create bills with new serial numbers, then, you know, intuitively that, you know, it seems like you must be breaking the pseudorandom function, right? Because, you know, now, you know, for some new serial number, how would you know, the value of the pseudorandom function on that new input, right? Having only seen its values on other inputs, okay, if it's actually pseudorandom. Okay, so to prove that, you have to give some hybrid argument that says that, you know, if we had such a counterfeiting scheme, then we could, you know, and if the original mini scheme was secure, then we can convert this into a break for the pseudorandom function. Okay, so we give what, you know, cryptographers would know as a hybrid argument. And anyway, so we do this. Okay, so let me get to probably the more interesting part, which is this trade-off theorem. Okay, so here's one way to state this trade-off between Wiesner and BBBW schemes. So let's just let M be any private key money, actually, or even public key money scheme, but then the theorem is trivial. So, you know, let M be any money scheme where the bank, you know, has some n-bit secret key, call it K star. Okay, then it is possible to break M, you know, using a polynomial amount of legitimate money, merely about n to the fifth dollars, okay, and a linear number of, you know, of queries to the bank, and an exponential quantum computation time. Okay, so you know, so in other words, you can break the scheme information theoretically, and if it's secure, then it can only be secure for a computational complexity reason. Okay, so, you know, why isn't this obvious? Well, it's because, you know, essentially, you know, the only way that a counterfeiter has to learn about the true key, K star, you know, is using the legitimate money states that it has, you know, plus, you know, a few verifications, you know, queries to the bank, but those really don't give it much information at all. Okay, and, but, you know, the problem is that, you know, these money states that you have are very precious, right? You know, you could, like, you might imagine that, okay, I'll just try verifying them for every possible choice of key. But okay, wait a minute, but then, you know, I may destroy them in the process, okay? And then, you know, and then I don't have money anymore, right? So, you know, and furthermore, these money states might happen, you know, to be accepted by many, you know, by many verifiers other than the true verifier. Okay, and so that may mislead you. Okay, so to prove this, we're going to use, you know, something that might be of some independent use in quantum information. So I'll call it the secret acceptor lemma. Okay, so what it says is let M1 up to Mn be any known two outcome POVM measurements. And now let rho be some unknown quantum state. Okay, and now suppose that we're promised that there is some measurement in this set that accepts rho with a high probability. Okay, so there's some I star such that, you know, M of I star accepts rho with probability at least P. Okay, and so what, you know, we would like to find a measurement in our set that accepts rho, not necessarily with probability P, but at least with probability P minus epsilon. Okay, with some, you know, well, you know, we can't really tell those two apart. Okay, but with some, we'd like to find a measurement that accepts rho with some good probability. Okay, now of course we could do this if we had, like, you know, more than n copies of rho, right? Then just try all possible measurements until you find the one that works. Okay, but what if you only have a few copies of rho? Okay, so the theorem says that it's possible to do this using only polylog n copies of rho. Okay, so log to the fourth n over epsilon squared, which could probably be improved. And, you know, and you'll succeed with very high probability. All right, so a sketch of the proof. So sort of the paper clips and, you know, and toilet papers that we'll use are, you know, just three things. You know, the Chernoff bound. Okay, you can always sort of amplify your state, take a lot of copies of it, you know, and measure them all in parallel in order to distinguish P from P minus epsilon with, you know, very, very good probability. Okay, with, you know, with almost zero chance of error. Okay, that's just the Chernoff bound. Secondly, there's the almost as good as new lemma that says that if, you know, if we push down our error probability to be, you know, very close to zero, then our measurements, you know, will only damage the state by a little bit. Okay, and then thirdly, there's a result that, you know, I've used previously in quantum complexity theory. I've called it the quantum OR bound. Okay, and this is just the statement that suppose you have a set of POVMs, the M1 to Mn, and suppose that some of them, you know, or some measurement in your set accepts a state rho with constant probability. Okay, then if you apply all of the POVMs to your state in succession, then that will, you know, then also at least one of them will accept with constant probability. Okay, why is this true? Well, you know, intuition is simple, okay? Suppose that when you get to, you know, Mi, right, the one that really does accept rho with high probability, suppose that by then rho has been left fairly undamaged, fairly close to what it was before. Okay, well then by assumption, Mi is going to accept it with, you know, with good probability. Okay, but suppose on the other hand that by the time it gets to Mi, rho has been really, really badly battered by the other measurements, okay, and completely damaged. Okay, well then Mi might not accept, you know, rho anymore. Okay, or in other words, it might no longer be rho, but if it's that badly damaged, then because of the almost as good as new lemma, that can only be because some previous measurement had a good chance of accepting it. Okay? So it's kind of, you know, a useful fact. All right, so now what we do is we consider all our set of all possible measurements, and we just divide it up into two halves. Okay, and so then, you know, in the first half, we first sort of try to figure out just is there a measurement, in, you know, among the first half that accepts rho with a good probability? Okay, with like P minus epsilon over log n, let's say. Okay, and you know, we use this quantum OR bound, and, you know, we use the tools above to try to answer that question. Okay, and then, you know, if the answer is no, then we also ask the question for the second half of measurements. Okay, is there one in here that accepts rho with good probability? Okay, by assumption, you know, there has to be, you know, something in either half that does. Okay, and then, you know, once we find out which, you know, in which half is there an accepting measurement, well, then we still don't know where in that half it is, right? Because you know, all we know is that something accepted, right? But that could be because something else damaged the state, right? It doesn't have to be because there's, the measurement that accepted might not be the same as the measurement that accepts the original undamaged row. Okay, but now at least we can recurse. Okay, we know which half of measurements to look at, so now we can do a binary search. Okay, and with each step of the binary search, we will decrease the threshold a little bit. So in the second level, we'll just look for a measurement that accepts a row with probability like p minus 2 epsilon over log n. Okay, and we'll keep decreasing in increments of epsilon over log n. And, you know, we'll keep using more, you know, fresh copies of row. And this is why we need like log to the fourth n of them. Okay, so with that secret acceptor lemma, I can now tell you what is the counterfeiting strategy for a counterfeiter with unlimited time. I'm gonna have a slide next that shows it more visually. Okay, but the basic idea is that you're gonna use sort of an iterative learning approach. Okay, let's let S be sort of the set of all the keys that you consider to be possible. Okay, that these might be K star. These might be the true key. Okay, so in the beginning, S is just the set of all, you know, n bit strings. Okay, and what we're going to try to do is repeatedly whittle S down. Okay, so repeatedly sort of get rid of a constant fraction of the elements of S. Okay, until we, you know, eventually we hit on, you know, either the right quantum money state, you know, dollars of K star. That would be great. Or, you know, if not that, then at least some other state that, you know, is accepted by the K star verifier with high probability. Okay, so what we do is we keep repeating the following, that, you know, I'll take just a random money state in, you know, in my set S, right? So just the mixture of all the of dollar K for all the K's in S. Okay, and I could submit that for trial verification. Okay, if it accepts, you know, or for let's say several trial verifications, so I can estimate the probability of acceptance. Now, if that accepts with high probability, hey, I'm happy. This wasn't a very secure scheme. Okay, but if not, then we have more work to do. Okay, so let's let U be the set of all possible keys such that if that were the key, then this sigma S gets rejected with high probability. Okay, and we know that U is not empty because it, you know, at the least it contains the true key. It contains K star. Okay, and now what we do, we use the secret acceptor lemma, and we use like n to the fourth legitimate bills in order to search for a key K prime in U, such that if, you know, K prime is the key, then the legitimate money gets accepted with high probability. Okay, and at least one such K prime has to exist, namely K star, right? We know that, you know, even though all the states in U accept, you know, all the keys in U reject sigma S, you know, with high probability, we know that K star is in U, and we know that K star accepts the K star money with high probability. Okay, so we find such a K prime, and then we eliminate from our set S every key such that K prime would reject the money K with high probability. And, you know, K star itself has to survive that, but the crucial observation is that a constant fraction of all the elements in S are going to get kicked out every time we do this. So if we had 2 to the n to start with, you know, we just have to iterate O of n times until this process has to halt with the money being accepted. Okay, so here's a picture. You know, you can imagine a table with all the possible quantum money states as the rows and all the possible verifiers as the columns. Okay, within this, you know, there's one money state which is the true one, K star. We don't know what it is. There's one verifier which is the true verifier. You know, of course, we don't know which that is either. Okay, but now, you know, S is our set of keys that are sort of still in the running, which will be, you can imagine, it's sort of gradually shrinking around K star. Okay, and then U is all of the verifiers that reject a random state in S with high probability. Okay, so again, we find some verifier K in U, not necessarily K star itself, but that accepts the legitimate money with high probability. Okay, and then we throw away everything in S that verifier K rejects with high probability, right? Which, because K was in U, has to be a constant fraction of the things in S. Okay, and we keep repeating. All right, so in just the remaining couple minutes, let me tell you about the issue of interactive security. Okay, so here, you know, as I said before, what we would like is a private key quantum money scheme that remains secure even if the counterfeiter can start with a polynomial number of legitimate bills and then repeatedly modify them and submit for verification. So as I said, you know, Gavinsky did this, you know, but in his scheme, the bill gets destroyed after about n verification. So interestingly, there was a paper by Farhi and Shore et al. Where they showed that even they showed that if the verification is just a projective measurement, then you cannot hope to have interactive security and also have the bill just be a bunch of unentangled qubits like it is in the Wiesner scheme. Okay, so at least the bill, if the measurement is projective and you want this kind of security, then the bill will have to be some highly entangled state. Okay, but we can give such a scheme where the bill is such a highly entangled state. Okay, and the way we do it is just by directly adapting the public key quantum money scheme that Paul Cristiano and I had previously. Okay, so what was our scheme? Well, very briefly, in our scheme, you know, it suffices to just tell you the mini scheme. So the money states would just be superpositions over all of the elements of some random subspace of, you know, of GF, of the vector space GF2 to the n. Okay, so in other words, like the set of all the code words in some random binary linear code. Okay, so the code should have dimension n over 2, so there's 2 to the n over 2 of these elements, and we just take a superposition of all of them, and that's the money. Okay, so such a state is certainly easy to prepare if I tell you a basis for this, you know, a set of generators for this A. Okay, on the other hand, it is also easy to verify, you know, it's easy to project onto this state, you know, even if I just give you oracles that test for membership in, well, in two things, in A and in the dual subspace to A. Okay, in other words, the set of all the strings that have inner product zero with everything in A. Okay, how do I do it? I just, you know, apply my oracle to make sure that all the elements of my superposition are in A, and then I Hadamard all the qubits, and then I apply the oracle to make sure that everything is in A dual. Okay, and you know, that just implements a projection onto this state. Okay, so I can verify, you know, only using these oracles. So what we did, you know, before is that we proposed a cryptographic method to instantiate these membership oracles without having to reveal A itself. Okay, this is where we use the multivariate polynomials. You know, but that's not directly relevant to us. Okay, for if we just care about private key quantum money, then as we'll see, we don't even have to care about how to publish a description of these oracles, because we're not going to publish a description of them. Okay, so what's more relevant here is you know, a theorem that we proved in our paper, which said that even if a counterfeiter is given membership oracles for both A and for its dual subspace, you know, and the counterfeiter is given a legitimate money state, dollar sub A, okay, it's still, the counterfeiter will still need exponential time, in particular exponentially many queries to these membership oracles in order to duplicate the money state with any non-negligible success probability. Okay, so this is the theorem that, you know, in this oracle setting, that this mini scheme is really just provably secure. And the proof of this was interesting. I'm not going to tell you about it in this talk, but it required sort of an adaptation of Bionis's quantum adversary method, okay, which was developed for, you know, for exactly the sort of thing, for lower bounding the number of oracle queries that you need to do some task. But here the task is copying a quantum state that's already given to you as input. So we had to deal with that. Okay, so now here's a corollary. I claim that if we now consider this hidden subspace scheme as a private key mini scheme, then it has to be not only secure, but secure against interactive attacks. And even, you know, in a setting with no computational or oracle assumptions. Okay, why is that? Well, here's a very simple proof. Okay, suppose by contradiction that an interactive attack existed against this private key scheme. Okay, then consider, you know, a public key counterfeiter. Well, he could just simulate the private key attack, but you know, anytime the private key counterfeiter would submit a bill to the bank for verification, then the public key counterfeiter will just use his Oracle access to A and A Dual to simulate that query to the bank. Okay, so thereby, you know, you would also break the public key scheme. Okay, but we already showed that the public key scheme was secure. You know, it's like, you know, fill the pot with water, you dump it out. You were reduced to a previously solved problem, right? That's what we do here. Okay, so, all right, so let me just mention some open problems. So first, you know, it would be interesting to sort of improve the parameters either of our secret acceptor lemma or of, you know, the proof of this trade-off theorem. Actually, another interesting question is whether you can get this break of the BBBW-like schemes, you know, with exponential computation time and with some legitimate money states, but without even having to query the, you know, without even having to make test queries to the bank. Okay, maybe you could even get rid of that entirely. So there's a lot to, you know, that could be improved there. Here's a question that I like. You know, if you want private key quantum money without a giant database, so you want BBBW like money, does that actually require like a pseudo random function or a one-way function? Okay, so you know, what's the minimal cryptographic primitive you need to get that, right? I proved that it requires some computational assumption, okay, but you know, what do you actually need? Okay, here's another question. Can we have private key quantum money which is secure against interactive attack without highly entangled bills? So with just, you know, a bunch of separated qubits, like in the Wiesner scheme. Okay, so, you know, we know from the Fahy et al. Result that if such a scheme exists, the verification will have to not be a projective measurement. Okay, we all, you know, and again, Gavinsky did give such a scheme, but you know, but it destroys the bill, you know, after n verification. So can we solve that problem? Okay, so, you know, another open question. Here's one of my favorites, because it's sort of such a weird question. Again, you know, another thing that sort of might seem so obvious that, you know, it's like it's not even a question at all, but then, you know, how do you prove it? Okay, so could you have an unconditionally secure public key quantum money scheme where all you would need to give to the verifier would be a random oracle? Okay, you know, so we gave such a scheme, as I said, where, you know, involving a non-random oracle, namely these hidden subspace membership oracles. Okay, you know, we also know how to get a private key scheme with a random oracle, namely Wiesner's scheme, but can you get a public key scheme with a random oracle? You know, either construct one or rule it out. Okay, and then, you know, one could ask about, you know, I've been interested lately in quantum software copy protection. Okay, so you could ask about private key copy protection, where, you know, you can't duplicate the state, but then, you know, if you want to use it to compute a function, then it requires interaction by the software vendor. You know, I mean, that sounds kind of hokey, but that's already a non-trivial task, right? So one could think about that. All right, so that's it. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, Scott. It was totally awesome. I have more a comment than a question, namely that the BBBV paper 1982.
BBBW.
BBBW is something else, that's right. Yeah. Well, first of all, it was the first paper ever published with in which the words quantum cryptography came out. Mm. But my comment is that our purpose writing this paper, our main purpose, was not to get rid of the giant database. Mm-hmm. The main purpose was to allow a verifier who does not have the secret to verify. In other words, it was a public key scheme.
Right, but the scheme wasn't secure.
No, it wasn't secure. It was not secure. Of course, it was not secure. But the purpose was to make it publicly verifiable.
Yeah, okay.
That's why we wrote this paper.
Good. Thanks. Yeah, thanks.
I was wondering whether you considered composable security for your private key money, because the kind of interactive attack you talk about looks like the problem which occurs when your security definition is not composable.
Sorry, can you speak up?
Have you considered composable security?
Yeah, that's a very good question. No, we haven't. We've just sort of worked on satisfying the security definitions that I showed you, right? But one could certainly try to write down stronger things like composable security. And so, it's quite possible or likely that some of the schemes that we already have would satisfy that, but it might require a new proof. No.
Questions? Any other questions? All right, we'll move on to our next talk. Okay.